Welcome to the Alex Jones Show on this Thursday, July 30th, 2015. I'm David Knight, your host. Alex Jones is going to be joining us with reports. Of course, he's in Europe, as we've pointed out this week. He's in Europe this week and next week doing reports on the globalist takeover of Europe. We've seen what happened in Greece. What is going to be happening next in Italy and Spain and Portugal and Ireland, these other peripheral countries there? What is happening with the move to criminalize the possession of cash so they can do the sorts of currency controls that we've seen in Greece? We're also going to have special reports from Paul Joseph Watson. Our reporter Joe Biggs is on location in Cincinnati to cover this latest murder by the police. This particular one was by a campus cop. Very egregious shooting. If you've seen the video, campus cop pulls over a black man. There's really nothing going on whatsoever, but we'll show the video. You can make up your own mind. He has been indicted for murder. That's the only good thing that has come out of this. We have a lot of news today, of course. We reported yesterday that there's a one-man insurgency to bring down John Boehner because the rest of the GOP doesn't really mind how he's betraying his Republican voters. We're going to talk about that later on. We're going to talk about Hillary Clinton. Camille Paglia thinks that she's not even going to make it to the primaries. Her popularity is plummeting, and for good reason. We have an article out from Mint Press. Actually, it's from Counterpunch, as carried by Mint Press, talking about Bernie Sanders' voting record being antithetical to his purported anti-war stance. It was just a couple of days ago that we talked about how, even though he's pushing for $15 an hour minimum wage, he pays his interns $12 an hour. How's that for hypocrisy? Well, even worse, especially for many people on the authentic left, people who really do care about the proliferation of wars and the consequences that it has for Americans and for others abroad when we get involved in unnecessary wars of empire. There's a long list of wars that he has supported, virtually all of them, going all the way back to Bill Clinton. They say that not only is he hawkish, not only did he essentially align himself with the Democrats more so than anybody else, 98% alignment with the Democrats after he got to the national stage, he was rewarded by support from the Democrat Party, financial support for his positions. He supported unequivocally Clinton's military actions in the Kosovo War in 1999. It caused one of his advisors to quit when anti-war activists occupied his office in 1999 because of his support for Clinton's war policies. He had them arrested. So much for the anti-war socialist candidate. We see this all the time. Of course, it was Alexis Tsipras' Socialist Party that really betrayed the people in Greece. He offered them the facade of choosing whether they were going to accept the banker bailout or not. And then when they surprised everybody and said, no, even though you have punished us with taking away our cash, shutting down the banks, essentially starving us financially for a week, they had them under financial siege. They still said, no, we're not going to take that deal. But he took it anyway. He betrayed the people. And now they're actually coming after the finance minister who was trying to work a way to keep Greece solvent. He actually talked in various forums about how we want to pay back this debt, but in order to do that, you cannot destroy our economy. You need to help us to grow so that we can pay you back. These austerity programs that you're proposing, and they were proposing even worse austerity programs that had taken 25% of their economy. He said, under these austerity programs, we're not going to be able to pay you back the debt. Don't you want to work with us so that we can pay back the debt? He came up with some novel ideas about how to keep cash flowing, and now it looks like they're going to do a criminal prosecution, or try to do that, of Yanis Varoufakis. So we'll see what happens. We're going to be talking again. Alex Jones from Europe, Paul Joseph Watson from Europe, and Joe Biggs from Cincinnati. Stay with us. We'll be right back. We're going to be joined by Alex Jones in special reports, perhaps live. Also, we have Paul Joseph Watson joining us from Europe live. Alex is in Europe, reporting, as I mentioned in the last segment, reporting on the globalist takeover of Europe, things that we have seen in Greece, things that look like they're going to be coming up with Italy, with Spain, perhaps with Ireland and Portugal, the people that the Germans and others in the center of the European Union have called the pigs, the P-I-I-G-S, those nations. who are now, we've seen what happens with Greece. Now the question is, will the other people, what will they learn from these lessons, and how is this going to move forward? How does this all fit into the globalist plan of the transatlantic partnership? As Alex had pointed out earlier in the week when he was in London, Obama was a huge hero there for telling England not to get out of the European Union. All these different nations, especially, it's a very strong movement in England. The UKIP party is dedicated to getting back their sovereignty. They did not get into the euro currency, but they did get into the European Union. Many people there are not happy about that. Many people in several European countries are not happy about that. There's a lot of independence movements. So they don't want the European Union to break apart before they can join it to America, because that's part of the plan. The Trans-Pacific and the Transatlantic partnerships are being negotiated in secret. The plan is to join all those together. It's a sovereignty-stealing plan. It's not just free trade. It's crony capitalism. It is something that's going to affect copyright laws. It's going to affect your privacy on the internet, control the internet. These are broad, sweeping measures that are getting no exposure whatsoever in terms of what they, except for what has been leaked by WikiLeaks. I want to take a look at an article that really caught my attention today, because this is something, of course, Alex Jones has talked about for a very long time. He was ridiculed as being a tinfoil hat conspiracy theorist because he said, hey, put something over your monitor, over your computer monitor, that little camera that's on the monitor. People can be watching you. Oh, you're paranoid. You're just paranoid. You think everybody's watching you. You're sitting here on the couch wearing a tinfoil hat. Well, now it's mainstream accepted news. Listen to U.S. News and World Report. Tape your webcam, they say. A few years late, but they are finally coming around. Horrifying malware can broadcast you to the world. They say the internet is flush with webcam videos of people who clicked unwittingly on a malware link and then opened their computer to anonymous miscreants intent on mocking, blackmailing, or simply spying on them. Anonymous miscreants who would blackmail or simply spy on you. We call those people, in many cases, the NSA or the FBI. I guess we have now have a new acronym. They say these are remote access Trojans, rats. Maybe we should just kind of include all these surveillance agencies into an acronym, remote access Trojans, and just call them all rats. We don't have to go through the alphabet soup of NSA, CIA, FBI. We can just call them all rats. I think that's a great way to approach this from here on out. They're Trojans, of course. And the question is, are our federal rats, our remote access Trojans, are they prophylactics or are they Trojan horses? That's the real question. Now, the Venezuelans are being thrown in jail for tweets if they criticize the government, because that's the next place where it's going. We've already seen Wesley Clark saying, if you're disloyal to the government, and we're going to determine that by watching you on social media. Are you depressed because you lost your girlfriend? You don't have a job? You got family problems? Whatever. We're going to watch you, and we're going to do something about it before you get radical, before you get violent. In other words, before you commit a crime, pre-crime. Because, you know, we're picking up people, not charging them with crimes, or taking their property, not charging them with crimes, not convicting anybody. So now let's just take people before there's anything being done. And of course, we have Mike McCall offering a bill that will be funded through FEMA under the Department of Homeland Security that would fund this pre-crime cyber violence that they say is coming, violent extremism, this new department to combat violent extremism. Here's what Venezuela does, because we're headed down the same road. Venezuelans are being thrown in jail for tweeting and criticizing the government on Twitter. Eight people have been jailed in the last 11 months for tweeting messages that the government found offensive or thought were a threat to the country's political instability. Who created that political instability? It was Hugo Chavez and the current guy that's there that sold the people out to the bankers, just like the socialist in Greece, Tsipras, the prime minister there. Bloomberg was bragging about how they got 700% return on investment out of Venezuela. They say these guys understand that they pay the bondholders first. And in that article, they were talking about how the citizens had to go to other countries to get food, water, medicine, but they were going to get their investments covered, and they were making a killing as they killed the people there. Now, listen to what they are doing here. These are charges that range from conspiracy. Oh, that's pretty broad, isn't it? Instigating hatred to espionage and, quote unquote, causing anxiety. Just cause anxiety. You know, like Wesley Clark says, you got a right to be disloyal to the United States, but we got a right to segregate you for the duration of the conflict. In other words, a war on terror that is never going to end. All these charges qualify for probation, defense lawyers say, but somehow, their cases have stalled. And five of the eight people are still behind bars. They say where they're being held is a Caracas prison that is guarded by intelligence personnel of the SEBIN, the Bolivarian Service of National Intelligence. You know what they call that building that they're keeping them in, the headquarters of the SEBIN? They call it the Tomb. That organization has been around since they had right-wing military coups. So they have right-wing military coups. They create this secret police organization. Their headquarters is called the Tomb. And then they change to leftist. Still stays the same. Nothing changes. Of course, a lot of those coups were created by our own CIA, just like the coup that preceded all the problems that we have between America and Iran, the coup of Iran that established the secret police, the Savak, in Iran. Of course, we never hear about that. As far as Americans are concerned, the first time they ever heard of Iran was when the American embassy was taken over. But we have a long history of our government, of the CIA, overthrowing governments and putting in military dictatorships, but more importantly, putting in a secret police, a tyranny. So why would we think that they would ever do that here in America? Why would we think there would ever be an overthrow of our government? Why would we ever think that they would do things, that they would act on things like the NDAA? You know, yesterday we were talking about, and just briefly covered the headlines, about how there's a new encroachment on us, letting the government take our passports without trial. This is something that probably Obama will sign. This is something that is being pushed by Republicans. This is a radical attack. This is an article we had yesterday on Infowars.com from New American. A radical attack on the due process of Americans. It's received virtually no media attention. That's why I want to talk about it again today. Without trial, without criminal charges. Where have you heard that before? Civil asset forfeiture for one. The NDAA for another. The war on drugs, the war on terror. They're all connected. It's all about an authoritarian government and the secret police who are going to run it. Now, of course, they give it a nice name. They say this is the FTO, the Foreign Terrorist Organization Passport Revocation Act. Oh, it's only for foreigners. It's only for terrorists. Remember, FISA was the Foreign Intelligence Surveillance Act. Now, that's being used as a rubber stamp for domestic intelligence surveillance. So forget about the foreign, forget about the terrorists, because we know that they're more interested in homegrown domestic terrorists. That's what Mike McCall's bill is about. That's what Wesley Clark's floating these balloons is about. They say it didn't even receive a recorded vote, supposedly because it was uncontroversial. It passed after 15 minutes of alleged debate. Hey, that's almost as much as they're going to give to the sovereignty-destroying, copyright-extending, privacy-destroying, internet-destroying, sovereignty-destroying, transatlantic, trans-Pacific partnership agreements. They're going to get 20 minutes, a little bit more than this. So they had 15 minutes of debate. The sponsor, Ted Poe, a Republican from Texas, said the measure was adopted under a suspension of the rules that's typically used for trivialities like renaming post offices or passing massive trade treaties negotiated in secret. Now, I added that last bit. Secretary of State may refuse to issue a passport to any individual whom the secretary has determined has aided, assisted, abetted, or otherwise helped an organization that the secretary has designated as a foreign terrorist organization. So that means people like Hillary Clinton, people like John Kerry will be able to strip you of your passport, will be able to confine you in the country without any due process, without charging you of any crime. And of course, we've already got something very similar to that with the TSA's no-fly list. They put people on that, never explain to them. They never know they're put on that secret list until they're refused the ability to fly. They're never given an explanation as to why, no due process. They're never confronted. Not only are they not confronted with their accusers in a court, They're not even confronted with their accuser, the government. They're not even, no trial, no process of any sort whatsoever. Now, as we see these issues with privacy and people being absolutely numb to it and the dangers of it, we have this article from the AP. Will the internet listen to your private conversations? They talk about a young girl whose mother gave her Amazon's new Echo device. This is a $180 cylindrical device that listens to what you're talking about so it can help to serve you better, to sell products to you. Her daughter thought it was so creepy, she unplugged the device and hid it. But of course, the mother doesn't have a clue. And here's the catch. They've got a lot of these things coming. We've got an upcoming Barbie doll that's going to do the same thing. Maybe we should call it the Klaus Barbie doll. Because it was Klaus Barbie, the Gestapo, who went to Bolivia and was involved in all this stuff I just told you about in Venezuela, the coup, the secret police. Okay, stay with us. We'll be right back. As I mentioned before, Alex Jones is in Europe. He's been in Europe this week, and he has a report from us that we're going to be playing in the next segment. Spain has fallen to EU tyranny. And of course, this is something that affects us all. It's not just something that's happening in Europe. This is part of a global plan, and right now, they're trying to join us economically to Europe. That's part of taking our sovereignty, creating an economic union, then creating crisis, then saying sovereignty has to be surrendered to the center. We're already seeing that in Europe. We've seen Alan Greenspan. We've seen massive bond companies, others saying the only way we're going to solve these problems like we have in Greece is for the countries to surrender their sovereignty. And of course, if you don't surrender your sovereignty, they take it anyway. That's what they did in Greece, as well as seizing their hard assets. So Alex is going to be joining us with that report in the next segment that we have. We also have Joe Biggs in Cincinnati covering the murder of a driver during a traffic stop. This is a campus cop who pulls a guy over and just shoots him in the head. An amazing video. We're going to play that video for you. We're also going to be talking to Joe Biggs in Cincinnati and to Paul Joseph Watson later in the show from the UK. Now, before we get back to the news, I just want to let you know this hour of the Alex Jones Show is brought to you by the high-quality products that we sell at InfoWarsLife.com. We have a special this week on Silver Bullet. Buy two Silver Bullet, get two free. We normally sell out of Silver Bullet during the winter months. Right now, you can stock up on this. It's 30 parts per million, colloidal silver. It doesn't spoil. It doesn't get bad. If you get four now, you get four for the price of two. And there's free shipping today and tomorrow through the end of July. We've had this special on all month. There's only 2 days left of it. Free shipping in July for everything that you buy at InfoWarsLife.com. And again, you can get Silver Bullet, buy four, for the price of two. So basically, you get it for 50% off. That's InfoWarsLife.com. Now, getting back to the articles that we're just covering here, because there was a little bit more that I wanted to say about these new devices. And I thought it was interesting that in the particular story that they had here from the Associated Press, the mother was the one who was buying this, but it was the daughter who was creeped out by having some device that was listening to everything that she was having to say. And again, as I point out, they're going to have Barbie dolls. I think they ought to put them in a Nazi uniform, a Klaus Barbie doll, maybe put it in its own, comes in its own personal internment camp that you can imagine that you're in. But this is all about the Internet of Things. You know, things like the doll Chucky from the horror movies. The Electronic Privacy Information Center, a watchdog group, wants the FTC to set security standards and strict limitation on the storage and use of personal information collected through internet-connected microphones and cameras. Well, that's great. That's a good idea, but it's not going to be stopped by legislation. It'll be stopped when parents get discernment. We have to understand where this is all going on. Now, of course, Amazon is saying that this device, the Echo, people don't need to worry about these devices eavesdropping on them. As a safeguard, it is programmed to only come on after it's activated with the press of a button or a certain keyword. Yeah, you know, like the webcam on your computer that now everybody is being warned about is easily hacked with Trojan horses, and they can watch everything that you do, put it up on the web, whatever. Good luck with that. Good luck with all of these things. You have to understand any kind of electronic device you have can be hacked and used, misused by other individuals, whether they're private individuals or whether they're the government looking to blackmail you, to spy on you, Or just to put collect all your data and put you in a massive database so they can run an artificial intelligence program through there and see if they think that you might possibly, according to that program, be a threat to them. Then they can pick you up and do something about it. One of the aspects of this information sharing that's very important, because understand that a big part of the way they get this information is getting it free from companies like Amazon or Apple. You know, when you talk to Siri, they record this stuff. All of these companies, your phone company, whatever, they take the legal position, the government does, they take the legal position that this information belongs to the corporation, to the phone company, to the computer company, to the toy company. And because they own information about you, they can turn it over to the government and they don't need a search warrant. That's one of the biggest loopholes in this surveillance state. And they want to increase that. They want to remove any liability from the corporations to make them reluctant. Of course, they have many ways that they can pressure the phone company with licenses, but they want to remove that liability for them. So they've brought to us several times CISPA, C-I-S-P-A. The P stands for protection. They're protecting the corporations. Now, they're offering it again, but without the P there. So you don't ask. It's just Cyber Intelligence Sharing Act. We all need to fight this. There's an organization that's fighting it called Fight for the Future. They're sending faxes to them. The ultimate obnoxious spam is sending a fax. They said, this is 1984 technology. Let's send it to you in 1980 faxes.
Alex Jones here, reporting live from Barcelona, Spain. We're also going to be reporting from Madrid and other cities. We're investigating the press reports that basically all of Europe is falling into classical tyranny with capital controls, restrictions on the press, persecution of even mild political speech, stuff that used to be a huge deal when other countries did it. So what's happening to the West? InfoWars.com is investigating. Now, I'd be very careful about what I say while I'm inside this country. We have not just discovered the fascism, the tyranny in the newspapers. In Zero Hedge in the United States, London Independent in the UK, basically breaking down the fact that 1984 has come to Spain. We have already experienced it and can't even talk about it until we get out of the country. And I'm not going to be at this point giving folks details about when we'll specifically be leaving and going to the next EU country falling under totalitarianism, in their words. That said, the headlines are everywhere. That people are being fined for criticizing police response times. No free speech. They announced just a month ago 10 things you can't do. One of them is criticize the king in any way. Now, again, this is supposedly a Western country. We hear criticisms of organizations and groups in China or in Cuba. And we were all brought up that was just absolutely horrible and terrible. But now, not just here, but in the UK as well, they're now nabbing people off the streets that try to go to Draw Muhammad cartoon events. So free speech is being eliminated. It's being expanded across the board. The United States is trying to bring this in as well. So I want to be clear. We're not picking on Spain. This is a beautiful country. I've studied its history a lot. It's amazing. It has an ancestral memory of being invaded by the Moors out of North Africa and then having to be reconquered by groups out of northern Spain and Europe. And they have been basically through a lot in the last 1,000-plus years. So it's ingrained in the culture to get in line with totalitarianism. But before I get into the latest developments, it's important to note that Francisco Franco, who in the early 30s basically staged a coup to take over Spain, then groomed Juan Carlos, who wasn't even in line to the throne, to be his replacement upon his death in 1975. Anybody can look this up. It was only Spain that didn't get in trouble at the end of World War II. Italy, of course, got in deep trouble. My grandfather was part of the invasion of that country. Germany lost 20-plus million people for the activities of the Nazi Party. Spain, that was the first fascist nation to basically join Germany, even before El Duce, Mussolini, never got in trouble for it. Now, I want to be clear. The communists killed more people in Russia and in China than the fascists did. So it's not a question of lesser of two evils. I understand why a lot of Spanish people didn't want to go under the tyranny of the Soviets, and they engaged in incredible atrocities and, quite frankly, made the fascists look like good guys. So I'm not comparing Franco to Hitler because I've studied it. He wasn't. But he did call himself totalitarian, and then they put Juan Carlos in 75. They supposedly had these faux reforms. They're now getting rid of those, and we have experienced it here. Not any security at the airport other than guys walking up with machine guns and staring at us in the face and doing it to everybody else, families, you name it, and then saying welcome to the country, letting us right in. Then we went to just get a couple hundred euros exchange to pay for taxis. It's a lot of taxis only take cash. And it was just, you know, incredible. Well, where's your hotel? Well, give us this. We'll give us that. And they were putting it in an Interpol database. Let us see your passport. Where are you going? How long are you staying? And they were putting it in an Interpol database right in front of us. See, capital controls are coming here. They're coming to Greece. You have 40% unemployment in this country. With the collapse of society, we're going to see a move towards totalitarianism that is going to stifle the incredibly rich culture of Spain and other countries. The problem is the globalists have sold socialism and communism as the answer to fascism when it's something that's even a more virulent variation historically than even fascism. But it's like, you know, picking strychnine or cyanide. They'll both kill you deader than a hammer. So this is a rich people, a rich culture, really nice folks, very, very polite, a lot of amazing, you know, obviously art is everywhere. The architecture anywhere you look is simply amazing, whether it's medieval or whether it's more modern. It's just that one thing is we're here. Down at one of the famous cathedrals, just videotaping it. And cops run over and get in our face and erase what's on our cameras and apologize for it, but they were bugging their eyes out at us. And they said, oh, we have to do this because of Islamic extremism. And understand this country got invaded and taken over by that. Then why is their government bringing it in at record levels? And then using it against people like us that came here with an open mind to try to basically investigate what's happening, what's unfolding. Again, there'll be a lot more that we're going to be reporting on in the next few days here, but this is not a free country. And the veneer of freedom is basically evaporating. It's basically being disappeared for the people that live in this once Christian nation. And as the Christian culture dies, which it's now doing, I mean, just 20 years ago, upwards of 90% of people went to church in Spain. And people say, oh, I'm sick of church. Well, the point is it was some culture. Now, something like 10% go. Same thing with England. And into that vacuum of globalist tyranny and the big banks looting people and the crony capitalism not letting the economy flourish, socialism is coming in and communism is coming in. And so they're putting a police state in place to counter that. So it's basically a choice of fascism or communism. And I just don't want either choice, but I'm not going to sit here and say that right-wing fascism is worse than communism, because historically, it's just communism is the worst thing there is. But that's the false choice you're given. We need to transcend that and have a culture of art, have a culture of true liberty around the Bill of Rights and Constitution itself that comes out of Magna Carta, itself that comes out and helped create the Renaissance that Spain's been a big part of when it comes to art and literature and everything else. So I come to you from the country of For Whom the Bell Tolls, of course, the Ernest Hemingway novel about the Spanish Civil War. He was here during the Spanish Civil War, but he wrote a fiction novel about it. George Orwell wrote a nonfiction book about his experiences here and was wounded fighting the fascists. And I totally get why he was fighting the fascists, but he even wrote in his essays, you can buy them in big compendium books, that turned out the communists were just as bad or worse. And that's what 1984 is about, is if Stalin would have taken over England and Europe, what the world would be like. And now we've just got the globalists in charge, who are just a high-tech version, in the words of Aldous Huxley, of a Brave New World model. So, again, we're not trying to give you buzzwords here. We're not trying to demonize anybody here. It's going to be the Spanish police whose children end up losing their future as well. And they're allowing fascism to come in. It's going to be set up. It's going to fall to corporate communism, where the corporations are offshore. They're above the law. They're exempt. Diplomatic immunity. And there's communism on the ground. In fact, I predict if the New World Order has its way and the EU superstate's able to implode what's left of national sovereignty to bring in this tyranny, I predict that these nations will all fall to a form of what I'm coining techno or technotronic or technocratic communism. And that's what we're facing because, again, it's communism on the ground, first socialism into communism on the ground to domesticate, to have controlled economies, with those controlled economies serviced by above-the-law megacorporations, less than 10 of them. There's about 100 right now, 6 media companies, 5 banks. But it's all consolidating right now, and all the ideologies, fascism, communism, all the fake choices we're given will mean nothing when this comes in. But remember, I'm in the only country that didn't fall at the end of World War II that was fascist. And they had a soft fascism after that, but it's back. And I can tell you, I've been in third world countries. I've been in Central America. I've been in totalitarian regimes. And in England, they're also passing similar laws. There has been a conscious decision made to do this. So keep an eye on us here. We hope to move to the next country and cover what's happening in Italy and in Greece and other areas. But they're moving to loot the Spanish pension funds. They're moving to loot people's private bank accounts now with bail-ins. This is coming to the United States, and that's why I'm here, was to investigate firsthand exactly what's happening. But just a beautiful country. Always wanted to come here. I've read so many history books about it. And I got to tell you, it's even more amazing than a lot of the stuff I saw in the central areas of London. Been there many times. We just picked a church courtyard here because it was a lot quieter from the city noise. This is not even a snapshot of what's happening and unfolding. I'm going to throw this back to a live transmission with David Knight. I'll be trying to call in or Skype in later in the broadcast as well. This is the most concerned I've ever been. Because let me explain something. Most countries like England and others that are becoming fascist, they care about the press. Or when Canada held me for 15 hours for no reason. You can tell, and you see it in the news, they don't care, folks. They don't care. And the police told me, we don't care. We'll be getting more into what's been going on since then. But this is a very, very serious situation. And it is very, very sad for this country. All right, Alex Jones signing off for InfoWars.com. More taped reports, more live reports, and more special reports coming. If you're watching this transmission, you are the hope of humanity. You are the resistance.
And again, that's Alex Jones reporting from Spain. And as he was pointing out, they have enacted recently very strict laws, not only against domestic reporters, but about anybody who's doing any kind of reporting. So he's very limited about what he can say. He said the police are getting into their face, telling them what they can and cannot report. I wasn't sure if he said that they took any footage from them. Probably did. As I'm hearing that and thinking about the long history of authoritarian government in Spain, as he pointed out, they were the only fascist government not to fall at the end of World War II. I'm thinking of the Monty Python skit, you know, where they're I can just vision Rob Dew and Alex Jones following a report. Like, nobody expects the Spanish Inquisition, right? Some guy jumps in front of him. Our three main elements are. I won't go into that whole thing. I'll spare you from that. But, of course, as we were pointing out before, we've already seen this happen in Greece. The Greek Prime Minister Tsipras says that Greece was forced to accept a recessionary bailout. He's not even trying to tell people that it's good for them. There's no way that you can put a positive spin on this thing. Why would he give the Greek people a referendum and then turn right around and give them a far, far, far worse deal? I mean, $50 billion in hard assets, another €36 billion and extend and pretend loans. And of course, the previous week, the economic minister, Varoufakis, would believe did not want to see cash controls put on and did not support that and thought that he had an agreement. He mentioned that at the beginning of the day on Sunday, and then by that evening, they had enacted cash controls. He said, we would never do cash controls. It's anathema to us. But by the end of the day, they had them. So there was this division even within that government. So I don't know how much of that they were forced to accept. I'm sure he would have liked to have done what the people in Greece wanted, but not so much that he would fight the globalists for it. He didn't have the will to do that. Now, today there has been a fourth Planned Parenthood video that has aired. This one is also very damning, and we're going to talk about that in just a moment. But, of course, the interesting thing is that even though Planned Parenthood is telling us there's really nothing here, this is just a hoax, it's phony, this is information that is not incriminating, you've got them telling all the media outlets, and the media outlets are pretty much playing along with it, as Camille Paglia was absolutely outraged. A feminist, she said. She supports a woman's right to an abortion. She has been a member of Planned Parenthood, but she was outraged by what these videos showed from Planned Parenthood and outraged about how they had been censored in the media. Now we've got Stem Express, one of the companies that's buying the baby parts, went to court to put a gag order on these videos, at least the ones that involve them. An LA Superior Court issued a temporary injunction Tuesday to stop the Center for Medical Progress from releasing any video showing three officials from Stem Express, a company that transfers fetal tissue from abortions performed at Planned Parenthood and other clinics to medical researchers. Stem Express said that they are grateful that its rights have been vindicated in a court of law, but the center said in a statement that the court threw out most of the company's requests. They say Stem Express is attempting to use meritless litigation to cover up this illegal baby parts trade, to suppress free speech, to silence the citizen press reporting on issues of burning concern to the American public. Yeah, they're called the Center for Medical Progress. Maybe we won't only get medical progress, but maybe we'll get some media progress out of this when people see how controlled the media is. This is a huge story on so many different fronts, because as this issue points out, it's not just Planned Parenthood selling it. It's the people who are buying the parts, creating the market, and doing the experiments for it. You know, it wasn't just the soldiers in the Nazi concentration camps who killed people or who performed these horrific procedures on their prisoners without their informed consent, like we now have the laws that are taking away our medical informed consent. It wasn't just those people who actually did it, but it was also the doctor, Dr. Mengele, who wanted it for research that he said was for the good of all mankind. It's always for the good of all mankind. It was for the good of all mankind when they did the Tuskegee experiments and lied to people telling them that they were getting treatment for syphilis when they weren't. That's what we always see as the answer for this. Now, let's take a look at this fourth video that just came out. We're not going to play a lot of the video here. We don't have very much time for it. But here are some of the things that were said in the video. I want to just give you a really quick rundown. This is a video that was done of Planned Parenthood of the Rocky Mountains. This is a facility in Colorado, does over 10,000 abortions a year. They have a contract to supply aborted fetal tissue, I would say to provide aborted baby body parts, to Colorado State University in Fort Collins. Here are some of the things that they said. Sometimes if someone delivers before we get to see them for a procedure, then we are intact. In other words, if somebody has the baby before they do the abortion, then we have an intact baby. Think about that. Let that sink in. If they have the baby before we see them for the procedure, we are intact. No, the baby is intact. So in other words, they're saying that if somebody has a second trimester birth, then they kill that child and sell the body parts. That's what they're talking about. Let's translate that for you. You can watch this. You can think for yourself. You can see these video clips. Some more things that they said. We'd have to do a little bit of training with the providers or something to make sure that they don't crush fetal organs during the second trimester abortions. This is absolutely amazing. They say putting it under research gives us a little bit of overhang over the whole thing. If you have someone in a really anti-state who's going to be doing this for you, you're probably going to get caught. But we got it figured out with our lawyer, Kevin Paul. He's got it figured out that even if, because we talked to him in the beginning, you know, we don't want to get you called on, say, selling body parts across state lines, which is what they're doing. So they know how to spin this. Stay with us. We'll be right back. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I want to go over a little bit more of this fourth video from Planned Parenthood. We're also going to talk a little bit about the report that is coming up. Joe Biggs is in Cincinnati looking into what is happening there after this campus cop was just shown on video shooting a motorist in the head. He has been charged with murder, but he has pled not guilty. So Joe Biggs is going to be joining us to talk about that in the next hour. We also have Paul Joseph Watson coming up later in the program. Before we get back to the news, I just want to let you know that this half hour of the Alex Jones Show is brought to you by the high-quality products that we sell at InfoWarsLife.com. Products like Knockout. As I've pointed out, there's a lot of ways that you can get your body back into a natural rhythm to try to get your sleep. You can get yourself off of artificial lighting. You can go camping, get back into the cycle of the natural sunrises and sunsets. You can hope that that's going to reset your melatonin cycle. And of course, that's a key part of what sets your sleep cycle. Many people use melatonin if they're traveling to reset their clock because of jet lag. But we have a new product at InfoWarsLife.com, Knockout. It uses sleep support ingredients like melatonin, but it also has valerian root, L-tryptophan, and other natural ingredients to help you get to sleep easier. Again, that's Knockout. You can find that at InfoWarsLife.com. And we have free shipping, not only on Knockout, not only on our buy two, get two free silver bullet, as well as all of our products at InfoWarsLife.com. We have that for the next 2 days through the end of July. So that's today and tomorrow. That free shipping for the month of July will end then. So stock up now. You can get everything for free shipping. And this Knockout product is, as part of its introductory offer, it is $10 off. That's 30% off of the regular price. Now, going back to this fourth video that we have from Planned Parenthood, as we had to go to break, I was just talking about how they were skirting the law. They said, if you're in a real anti-state, anti-abortion state, you're going to have somebody doing this for you. You're probably going to get caught. But we have a lawyer, they say, Kevin Paul. He's helping the affiliates skirt the fetal tissue law. Here's a quote from the video. He's got it figured out that he knows that even if, because we talked to him in the beginning, you know, we were like, we don't want to get called on, you know, selling fetal parts across states. And the buyer asks in the video, and you feel confident that they're building those layers of legal protection, layers of plausible deniability, layers of gray area, they say. Says, oh yeah, I'm confident our legal will make sure that we're not put in that situation. They know that's what they're doing. They know that's what they're doing. But they're going to game the system in order to do that. Now, they have 9 more videos that are planned. There's already been a restraining order put on them that would apply to any videos that would include STEM Express. STEM Express, again, is part of this. They are providing the market for these parts, as well as the federal government providing the market for these baby parts. As we've got an article on InfoWars.com talking about the 9 more videos coming out, Steve Watson has some tweets in there. This is from Fox News. They say, LA judge issues orders preventing publication of anti-abortion video. Troubling at best. Someone named Truth Agenda replies, Planned Parenthood insists that it isn't worried. Yeah, right. Somebody is very worried. But of course, the Planned Parenthood president says these extremist videos, that sounds like the kind of language that could get you locked away in one of Wesley Clark or FEMA's internment camps. These extremist videos are nothing short of an attack on women. No, they're actually an attack on women and men, because that's what these babies would become. They say they're being secretly filmed without consent. Yeah, it's called a sting operation. I have a picture here from Abby Johnson, who was with us earlier in the week. She testified in Texas. She said, this is what it looks like when Planned Parenthood is called to testify. And it's a picture of an empty room that didn't even bother to show up. Stay with us. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight, your host today. Joining us in the next segment will be Joe Biggs. He is in Cincinnati, Ohio, covering the recent indictment of a campus cop there who pulled a motorist over and shot him in the head in a very short period of time. We're going to play that video, and we're going to talk to Joe Biggs in the next segment. I was just talking about the furor that has happened over these Planned Parenthood videos, a fury that is limited to one side of the political spectrum, because Planned Parenthood has been very effective at censoring this in most places. When we look at USA Today, when we look at Reuters, all these different outlets, there is absolutely nothing about these Planned Parenthood videos. Yet we see all of these videos and presentations, as I covered yesterday, about Cecil the Lion. There's all these, we got a video of Jimmy Kimmel who is weeping about this. Of course, you know, we had John Boehner weeping about his golf game earlier in the week, but he can't be concerned about what's going on in these Planned Parenthood facilities. Camille Paglia, who is a feminist who supports abortion rights, is very concerned about it, and she's concerned about the censorship. But of course, not the mainstream media. There was an article today, however, that touches on this story that we're going to be talking to Joe Biggs in the next segment about. Really kind of bridges the two of them. As I mentioned yesterday, you know, when they look at Cecil the Lion, I thought there were a lot of striking ironies and parallels between what happened to Cecil the Lion and what happens to people in these abortion clinics. As Abby Johnson had pointed out, the luring of women in under the pretense of family planning, pushing them to have an abortion with a quota that she was given as a director of a Planned Parenthood facility. And that's precisely what happened with the Lion. People are outraged that he created a gray legal area by luring the Lion out of the preservation area so he could kill him. They were outraged that the Lion died painfully over a long period of time, but they're not outraged when children are ripped apart. And that was one of the things that caused Abby Johnson to resign from Planned Parenthood when she saw the lie of Planned Parenthood that these babies don't feel any pain. She saw the child recoiling on ultrasound as they were crushing that particular one with their forceps. And of course, they were outraged that Cecil the Lion's head was taken as a trophy, but they're not outraged that they would sell baby parts to get a trophy car. How about that? Are you outraged? You ought to be. But of course, USA Today doesn't put it out there. Reuters doesn't put it out there. But USA Today has fury over Cecil the Lion also sparks race conversation. Okay, I agree. We ought to talk about that analogy too. Is it going to be open season on motorists, open season on black people, open season on anybody that the cops choose to kill? Do they have a license to kill? Is that what a police badge today means? Even for campus cops, that you have a license to kill? Now, he has been indicted. He probably will be treated differently because he is a campus cop, because he isn't an official police cop. And that's a good analogy to talk about. And we should have that discussion as well, because that is also a big problem. And people are far more concerned about Cecil the Lion than they are about this motorist that was killed. So we're going to talk to Joe Biggs when we come back. Just briefly, some updates on Hillary Clinton. Yesterday, we saw on the Drudge Report all of these articles about a new book coming out about Secret Service agents' recollection, talking about how the marriage between Bill and Hillary is a sham, that it is simply there for appearances so she can run for president, talking about how if they are put on the detail to protect Hillary Clinton, that is considered to be a punishment detail. You know, kind of like if you're a German soldier getting sent to the Russian front. We've got news articles about UBS deal. One of the first things she did when she became Secretary of State was smooth things over for UBS. And of course, the banks are big supporters of her. It's amazing that even The Onion did a parody piece saying Clinton had been given 3 weeks of suspension by the FEC for spitting on her staffers. That's the arrogance that even people on the left see. Stay with us. We'll be right back with Joe Biggs. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight in Austin, and joining me here in studio is Leanne McAdoo, one of our reporters from Players and Planet TV. That's where I hang out. That's where Leanne hangs out. Joe Biggs, our reporter, is in Cincinnati. He is looking at this murder, and it is a murder, I believe. It is, of course, he's been indicted for murder. He's been indicted for voluntary manslaughter as well as one count of murder. It's kind of interesting that they would indict him for both of these things. I don't really understand that, Leanne. But we're going to be talking to Joe Biggs. And before we talk about the details of this, let's play this video so that you can hear, and we'll try to describe what is happening if you need any narration for this. I'm not sure how good the audio is on this, but we're going to play this video. This is a campus cop at the University of Cincinnati. He pulls over an individual, Samuel DeBose, a black man. He pulls him over for a traffic stop. This is about a half mile from the university's campus. I don't know. He's a campus cop. Is he even out of his jurisdiction? I'm not sure, but let's play this video.
Well, until I can figure out if you have a license or not, go ahead and take your seatbelt off for me.
I ain't even doing nothing.
Go ahead and take your seatbelt off. Stop.
Man.
Wow. Well, until I can figure out if you have a license.
So that's the body cam. He's trying to figure out if he's got a license.
Right. He was pulled over, stopped for not having a license plate on the front of the vehicle. The man is calmly explaining, I have it right here. It's in my glove compartment. During the whole interaction, he's calm. He's not being belligerent. You can see the full video. We have it up at InfoWars just to kind of see how quickly they spoke for about 2 minutes. Mm-hmm. And then it took him all of 2 seconds. He was trying to open Samuel DeBose's door.
Yeah, he wanted him to get out, which he doesn't have to do that.
He doesn't say get out.
Yeah, yeah. Well, exactly. But I mean, he says, I don't have my license, but I'm in the system.
Mm-hmm. Right. He said, here's my name. You can look me up. And he says, well, why don't you have your license? Let me know. You know, is it suspended? And he's like, no, it's not. I don't have it on me. And so then he starts to open his door and the man puts the key in the ignition and he starts to take off. And you hear the cop saying, stop, stop. And I mean, that fast, he just shoots him right in the head. And, you know, I knew when I uploaded this video last night that I was going to get the typical racist trolls on there. But what I was not expecting to see were so many comments from the obsequious police state mentality of people saying he deserved it.
Yeah.
He deserved to be shot in the head.
You got to be shot in the head right off the bat. We have reported over and over again about how America compares to all these other countries. Countries that will have over 20, 30 years, they might have one situation where the cops fired their gun in anger, where one person was killed. I forget what country it was. I reported on the nightly news last week. They had fired one shot in several years, and they didn't hit anybody. Okay, it was a warning shot. We used to have warning shots. We used to have cops who were not always afraid for their life, as they say. That's the alibi that they use in every one of these situations. Look, when we saw all these shootings in New Mexico, and we learned, you know, there was that video where they shot that homeless man in the hills, mm-hmm. and we learned that New Mexico was shooting more people, killing more people than New York City was, even though New York City has many, many times more people. And as everybody started to focus on New Mexico, there was a police officer there who was a trainer in the state police academy who said, we've been given a federal training curriculum that is a shoot first curriculum.
Right.
And I refuse to teach it. So they said, fine, you're fired. Mm. That's the way any good cops are being driven out. And they're pushing this agenda from the federal government.
Right. And where does it end? How can you justify, oh, well, he deserved it. The cop had his arm in the window, grabbed onto his seatbelt. He could have just let go. You know what I mean? He wasn't in danger. There was no weapon that we could see or anything. And it takes him 1 second to shoot this man in the head. Where did he get his weapons training?
Yeah. Well, what people need to understand is when you get training for a gun or concealed carry or whatever, they explain what the law is to you as a citizen. If somebody comes into your home and they're a robber that's coming into your home, it's not a burglary, you're there, and they start stealing stuff from you, you're not allowed to kill them if they're running away. Even if they got a very valuable item of yours and they're running away, you're not allowed to kill them unless they're coming at you, unless they are threatening your life. And that applies to the police as well, or it should. In a just society, the police, unless their life is in danger, they should not be taking lives. This is over a traffic stop.
Right.
Just like Eric Garner was killed because he was supposedly selling unbundled cigarettes to get them out, to make a little bit of profit off of the confiscatory taxes that they enacted in New York City. So they choked him to death.
Right. Or we have the case of David Eckert. I believe that was also in New Mexico. He failed to stop completely at a stop sign. So he got pulled over and a police officer thought he was clenching his butt cheeks. So he was subjected to 14 hours of forced medical procedures. This was last year. They gave him cavity searches, x-rays, colonoscopies, and they even tried to make him pay for that forced medical procedures they subjected him to. And it's all because the cop thought, oh, well, you know, you tightened up your butt cheeks, so you deserved it. And that's what it just makes me so angry is people saying, oh, well, you deserve to get shot in the head because an officer didn't want you to get away. He had never said you're under arrest. He never charged him with anything. There was nothing that he was saying, okay, you know what, step out of the vehicle.
They can allege anything and they can get away with anything. I mean, look at this lady that died in Houston. Picked up for a minor traffic violation. They arrested her because they didn't like her attitude. She's there for 3 days and then is hung in her jail cell. They say that it's suicide. That doesn't seem plausible. But when they say that she committed suicide because she consumed massive amounts of marijuana on day 3 in the jail, I mean, this, yeah. It gets more ridiculous. We see what this is about. We see through this. It's very transparent what's going on here. And although there's a lot of people who are enabling this behavior, as you talked about trolls on social media, there's a lot of people who are applauding that. There are a lot of people who are getting really angry about this. Let's go to our reporter in Cincinnati, Joe Biggs. Joe?
Joe Biggs here with Infowars.com. I'm actually at the Hamilton Courthouse in downtown Cincinnati. Now, we came out here to kind of find out what's going on with the Sam DeBose case. We know that Officer Ray Tensing has had his bond set at $1 million now. Now, this is the officer who pulled over Sam DeBose in a traffic stop for not having a license plate on the front of his vehicle. And at that point in time, he asked him if he even had a license on him. They talked back and forth. And it appeared that Sam DeBose even had his license on him. So at this point in time, Officer Tensing asked Mr. DeBose to take off his seatbelt and exit the vehicle. At that time, Mr. DeBose then reached for the door and pulled it back shut. Now, this is kind of where the story gets a little weird, because the officer said that when the door shut, that he got stuck to the car and the car took off and he was dragged, which didn't happen.
Yeah, you can see that from the video camera.
You can look at it frame by frame and see.
Yeah.
He fell back.
Well, I mean, and on top of that, you have the other officer that was there as well that you see it towards the end of the video, who was approaching the vehicle after the guy had been shot in the head, you know. And he corroborates the same story. He says that the officer was dragged. Now, if that were us as civilians doing that, we would get indicted on, you know, falsifying a report. Mm-hmm. We'd be in trouble for something like that. But this guy, you know, clear as day, goes up to the vehicle. They struggle for a second, and then he shoots him in the head. I mean, that is
right. Murder,
straight up.
He grabs onto his seatbelt.
And then you have Megyn Kelly from Fox News coming out saying that she doesn't quite believe that Ray Tensing should be held on murder charges. I think that's very interesting that she could even come to that conclusion.
Well, you know, because sometimes you just need to have Big Brother, and this is evidently one of those times. It's not evidently just when you've got big pharma profits involved. She said that initially about vaccines and about forcing people against their informed consent to take vaccines. Megyn Kelly said, well, sometimes you just need Big Brother. I guess you need Big Brother whenever there's a traffic stop, and they need to be able to shoot you if you don't obey their orders.
If you give them attitude.
The interesting thing is, though, is Ray Tensing defense team is going to try to push for self-defense. Self-defense from what?
Well, that's the only way they could get him off, because you know as well as I know, Joe, we're talking about that before you got on, that you're not allowed to kill other people unless your life is in danger. So they always try to make it sound as if their life is in danger. But they're shooting people in the back. They're creating situations where they don't have any threat to their lives. Look at Eric Garner, where he was choked to death. There was no threat to the lives of those officers there.
But look at it this way, though. Imagine if that police officer, or ex-police officer, I should say, didn't have his body cam on him, then the narrative would have been the lies told in that police report, and everyone would have believed that story. Thank God that camera was on, and you actually know what happened.
Yeah, we wouldn't have known about that shooting in the hills outside of Albuquerque, New Mexico, if it hadn't been for body cams. But subsequent situations in New Mexico, even though there was a major scandal in Albuquerque about corruption, the police chief left. He went to work for a company that sold body cams to the city at a very expensive rate. And then these body cams, for some reason, were not turned on in many cases, or they lost the data for that. So that's the other way that they spend that. But one of the things that you said, and we all do this, Joe, we all start using the language civilians. Can you imagine if it was a civilian? And I think that betrays the whole militarized mindset that we're seeing of the police. And we're buying into that as well. I remember the first time I heard that was in Dirty Harry. And I thought it was kind of a cynical joke that the cops would refer to people as civilians. Maybe they were doing it that far back. But that definitely is the situation today, because we have a militarized police. And those rules of engagement are being driven by the feds, pushing out this shoot first curriculum.
Yeah, I mean, like that's what I've been saying, you know, since day one when it comes to all these different, horrible acts, is the fact that this is all stemming from the training. It's not the individual officers themselves. You know, sometimes that definitely plays a part, but it's the training. When you train someone properly, when you train someone how to deal with these certain situations, they don't react that way. And when you get someone who's untrained, you give them a badge, you give them a gun, they make stupid mistakes.
Right.
Absolutely. We've got to go to break. Stay with us. We're going to be right back with Joe Biggs in Cincinnati, covering this shooting in Cincinnati. Also joining me is Leanne McAdoo. We'll be right back. Coming up at the bottom of the hour, Alex Jones is going to be joining us reporting on the collapse of Europe. He's going to be joining us from Spain with a live report, so stay tuned for that. Now, before we go back to Joe and Leanne, I just want to let you know this hour, the Alex Jones Show is brought to you by the fine products that we sell at InfoWarsLife.com. These are the products that we support our operation with. You can support us as well as supporting your health. And we know that the feds are stockpiling tens of millions of doses of low-quality iodine for an emergency. But as we talked about yesterday with Steve Quayle, there is a gradual accumulation from Fukushima, from other sources of radiation in the environment, in addition to the deficiency of iodine in most people's diets because they don't get it as a supplement. Right now, we have in stock Survival Shield X2 nascent iodine. It's in stock. It's not going to go bad, so you can stockpile high-quality iodine that not only protects your thyroid, but also protects your health because it's a vital nutrient that you need. And we have free shipping for the next 2 days. Free shipping in July, and of course, that ends tomorrow. So you can stock up on Survival Shield X2 and get free shipping right now at InfoWarsLife.com. Leanne, as we were talking about this shooting that happened in Cincinnati earlier in the program, I talked about how the USA Today talked about the fury over Cecil the Lion, but saying there's no fury over these shootings that are part of police brutality. And of course, we've seen that the left, USA Today, other mainstream media outlets, don't cover the Planned Parenthood brutality.
Right.
So we have this dichotomy on the left and the right where the left excuses the brutality of Planned Parenthood, the right excuses the brutality of the police.
Right. And that's the thing. It's either all lives matter or they do not matter. I mean,
That's right.
The same people who are in an uproar about the Planned Parenthood videos are also sitting there saying that this guy deserved to get shot in the head or Kelly Thomas deserved to get beaten for half an hour on camera.
But they're all concerned about Cecil the Lion.
Yes.
It may not be white lives matter, black lives matter, human lives don't matter, but Cecil the Lion's life matters more than any of this systemic problem. Joe Biggs, your comments.
Well, the interesting thing that's going on is the establishment wants these race wars. They're pushing to see this happen. In Ferguson, it worked. The plan completely unfolded the way they wanted to. You know, the burning down of the city, the complete and total meltdown of that entire town, the lack of leadership from Ferguson to help the youngsters through this. And now you've seen a switch. Now you've seen the people kind of stand up and say, screw the establishment. We're not going to let you do this to us, because you saw it in Cleveland when they stood up, when there could have been possible riots. The outcome of Tamir Rice, the outcome of the officer jumping on top, Michael Brillo, jumping on the hood of the car and shooting 15 rounds into the windshield, killing two people. You know, the fact that you had the shooting in Charleston where the people rose up and said, we're going to be better than this. You're not going to destroy this. We're not going to burn our city down. And then now you have another city that starts with a C. Everything happens in threes. We're in Cincinnati. And this horrible act has happened. This police officer murdered this man in cold blood. Straight up, there's no other way you can look at this. There's no other way to define what happened. This guy is trying to claim that he did this in self-defense, which is another horrible, disgusting lie. This guy should be buried under the jail cell. But you're going to see Cincinnati rise up out of the ashes, and they're going to be a beacon of light for other cities. And that's what we're seeing, though. In these cities, the leadership that steps in, when you have people who actually care about what's going on and the town comes together, they beat it, they overcome what the establishment wants, and the race wars don't happen. Now, they're still trying to push for it, and you still got a lot of people out here with mixed emotions, not really understand what's going on. Young children who are just angry, and they're using this as a way to let that anger out. But, you know, I heard something interesting.
Go ahead.
I heard something interesting earlier where there was a car driving by honking their horn. And they're like, yeah, we got justice for Sam DeBose. Well, guess what? Sam DeBose was taken. His justice was taken for life when he was murdered. He doesn't get justice anymore.
That's right. That's right. And the man has only been indicted. He hasn't been found guilty. We don't know what his punishment, if any, would be, because that's the other aspect of it. I mean, it was totally outrageous when they would refuse to even indict people. But it's also outrageous when we see that they get slaps on the wrist.
Well, Leanne, I mean, the president, though, that they sent for setting $1 million bond, then they only really have to pay 10% of that. They can start a GoFundMe if they really wanted to and get this guy out of jail, a murderer who killed this guy.
That's right.
That kind of sets a precedent.
Well, we can obviously see how important these body cameras are. I mean, but it obviously didn't stop him from lying in the initial police reports. It didn't stop him from carrying on with the story, but at least we were able to, you know, get an indictment at this point in 10 days.
Yeah, absolutely. 10 days. Well, of course, we saw the report from the Home Secretary in the UK saying she wasn't going to use water cannons, other militarized equipment on the streets of England because they had to get back to this idea of consensual policing. We have to get back to that. And if they don't deliver penalties that are commensurate to that, we have to take action about that through democracy. Now, joining us right after the break will be Alex Jones from Europe. Joining us now live from Spain is Alex Jones. He's there covering the collapse of Europe, looking at where the bankers will move next. And as Alex pointed out earlier in the show with his report that he sent in, he's in Spain where they have recently enacted some very stringent rules against free speech, not just for domestic journalists, but also for people who are visiting there. So joining us now is Alex Jones in Spain. Alex?
Thank you so much, David, here on this July 30th, 2015 global transmission. I do come to you live from Barcelona, Spain, and I look at the headline, Satanic cult used profits from Baphomet statue unveiling to fight anti-abortion efforts. Why wouldn't they support child sacrifice? The New York-based devil obsessed cult known as the Satanic Temple used funds from a recent PR-driven Baphomet statue unveiling in Detroit to fund an effort to undermine legal moves to ban abortion after 20 weeks, as well as other anti-abortion legislation. That story with video of the group, whether they're black or white or Hispanic, they all have green skin. All so white, the skin's green. And anytime we go out and demonstrate and try to save babies, out of nowhere just appears these ghouls. And you look at them, they have chicken necks, they're incredibly weak, they stumble over potholes, they can hardly walk, but everyone just bows down to them instead of warhammering them. I mean, they want to sit there and feed on innocence. Let's let them have a real fight politically. They need to be warhammered. I mean, we don't serve a weak God, ladies and gentlemen. We serve the powerful God that created the universe. And the devil's taken over the churches and all these other systems, and that's why we are in the situation we are, bowing down to these piles of simpering, stinking, dead flesh that are self-propelled, walking around animated by their weak, fallen God. These people make me sick. And I didn't mean to get up here and start preaching. I apologize. It's just the falling down and worshiping the green skin maggot vomit that is Satanist makes me want to throw up. I mean, put me in a ring with them. I'll take five of them on at once. Give them battle axes. Give me one. I guarantee you I will send them all straight to hell. These people are weak. And I'm tired of them ruling over us. I'm tired of them. They make me want to throw up. But the good news is humanity is rising and the globalists know it. And that's why they're working as hard as they can to try to shutter our minds, shutter our souls, and put us in their false reality so they can control us, because these evil people are afraid of those of us that are awake and tied into God and tied into the universe. Now, I'm going to stop the preaching right there. I'm going to stop for a moment. But I tell you, I knew in my gut about 3 weeks ago, I started saying, hey, I think I might go to Europe, watching the meltdown, watching the collapse of the economies in Greece and Ireland and Spain and Portugal and France and the UK, watching all this happen. I said, I just feel like in my gut, I need to get to Europe and see what's happening. And I did my own research, talked to a lot of experts, and they said, next up is Spain, next up is Italy. So we're going to Spain, we're here, we're going to Italy, we're going to Greece. We've already been to the UK that has the main banking command base in the city of London, within London, running it all, above the law, diplomatic immunity. The British people aren't running it, want to be clear. They always misrepresent. The globalists are based there to a great extent. They're based in D.C., they're based in Israel, they're based in the Vatican. Nothing against Catholics, nothing against Jews. The globalists are separated out in different, above-the-law, diplomatically immune command bases. And who else is diplomatically immune and in command bases? Royalty. And I knew all this history, but once I got here to Spain a couple days ago, I began to do research just to double check my memory. And I was like, my gosh, this is crazy. Juan Carlos was way down the line in Royal Secession. The Spanish people had already voted pre-fascism, pre-communism, to get rid of their monarchy, not to arrest them, not to kill them like the communists did to the czars in Russia, but to just say, you know what, you don't own 300 palaces, you don't own the oil companies and the shipping firms and the people, we're not feudal serfs anymore, we're free. Because it was feudalism in Spain. The people were owned by the royalty. They weren't owned by the royalty pretty much before the La Reconquista, but when the royals came in, backed by European nobility, Germanic and others, to kick the Islamic takeover, the Moors, out, one tyranny for another, they became true feudalists. I mean, the people were the property after the La Reconquista. And let's be honest, they were historically treated better than under Islamic rule. That particular North African Islamic rule was one of the most brutal there is out there. Slave trade, everything. Which, why the Spanish picked up the slave trade after La Reconquista was because they were taught it by the North Africans. Again, I'm just saying the political correctness. I'm not Islamophobic, but the modern slave trade, the Atlantic slave trade, was taught to Spain and Portugal by the Moors. Who? They didn't care what color you were. If they could grab you, they'd enslave you. If you were a woman, they didn't care what color you were, they'd enslave you. So why slavery? So I'm here in this incredibly historic place that gives us echoes of what's happened in other periods in history and how what they went through in the last 1,000 years plus here in Spain, and finally Spain being freed by the wise one or El Cid and others. It's just epic to see what's now happening once again here in Spain. The people, you hear on the news, you hear the Greeks are lazy. It's all their debt. They're lazy. They only work 6 days a week. They should work 7 days a week. You know, they should pay 100% taxes. They're a bunch of lazy scum. And then you look at the statistics of the Greek people. They work very hard on average. Some of their public sector and private sector pensions are a little unsustainable and based on derivatives. But that's not the general public. So you hear they all owe these debts. They deserve it. Well, I've been here in Barcelona, and I've been in some of the other cities. We're going to be traveling with some others. And the people are the most hop to it, on top of it, hardworking, super service-oriented that I've ever seen. I mean, boy, if this is lazy people, we need some of this in the United States. And I talked to some of the locals, a lot of InfoWars fans we've run into. Some of those videos are going to get uploaded. These folks are working 6 days a week, 10 hours a day. They've had their taxes raised and raised and raised and raised and raised. Their government has submitted to the EU takeover and all the VAT taxes and the rest of it. It's all selectively enforced. And they've got Catalonian separatist movement here where I'm at in Barcelona in Catalonia, just over the mountains to the north is France. And they want to be their own country. They're a mix of French, Germanic slash Spanish. And it's an older culture than most of Spain. The culture is more than 2,000 years old. And they're pretty much the original Spanish culture that got overrun and taken over. And they're just like, you know what? We're productive. We work hard. We're smart. We don't want to be under Juan Carlos and the EU. We want to be free. And you see Catalonian flags on almost every house and almost every apartment hanging over the side. And, of course, it didn't matter how they voted or what they wanted. Still, they were put under EU rule, where the EU unelected bureaucracy dominates and controls every facet of what they do. But separate from that, as you heard in the first hour, we covered Zero Hedge, we covered the London Independent and others. The London Independent called it bizarre police state. It's so over the top that if you say anything about Juan Carlos, the King of Spain, if you say you think he's ugly, if you say he looks, pardon me, David?
No, they just handed me some information. Alex, the IMF is now saying that they're not going to give Greece the bailout. This is amazing. Even after the betrayal of the Greek people by the prime minister there, the socialist prime minister for the European Central Bank and the IMF and others, they're now saying they're not going to even honor that agreement.
Because the plan of the EU, as we said 20 years ago, as we said 10 years ago, as we said in Endgame, as we said in the Obama deception, as we said on record, because the heads of the EU have said this, is to take over nation states, get them in debt, implode them, and then end national sovereignty. So continuing here with this breakdown, you see the moves of people desperate to be free, desperate to get out from under 75% taxation as they have on average of even blue-collar workers in Spain. 95% taxes on the middle class, 101 on the nouveau riche, 101% 3 years running in France, just north of me, to bankrupt new wealth that threatens the hegemonic rule of the ultra-rich who are above the law and don't pay taxes. So that's what this whole story is about. What you see happening in Spain, what you see happening in Greece, what you see happening in these areas is what's coming to the United States. When we got off the plane, I needed to exchange some cash so I could pay for taxi fares and stuff. Because a lot of folks want to be in the cashless, want to be out of the cashless society, so they want cash. So I tried to get $300 changed into euros here in Spain. And they wanted my passport, my driver's license, where I was staying, what I was doing, what I would spend the money on. They admittedly are bringing capital controls to Spain, just as they've done to Greece, because they're getting ready to take people's bank accounts with the bail-ins. This is the exact same culture being brought to America. It is so draconian to see our world being captured by these criminals. And then to see how a lot of experts thought they wanted Greece to default. That's why they gave them deals, the last three bailouts that were untenable, that would bankrupt them. And even when they agreed to an increase of VAT of 15 percentage points on everything sold in the country, even when they agreed to most of their public and private sector companies being taxed and handed over to foreign banks, even as they agreed to having their islands turned over, even as they agreed to total financial enslavement, it wasn't enough, as you're now reporting, that they're saying, we may not just give you this bailout. This is the predatory plan. And it's why here in Spain, Rob Due was out just videotaping on a street of a cathedral. He wasn't filming the police. They were back in the background, looked like ants in the shot. They march over and they said, under the new laws, we can arrest you for doing that. Grabbed his camera, erased it, erased the information, and then told us, because of Islamic terror, we have to now take your freedom. And we're sorry, but we have to. And I started saying to them, and they spoke somewhat decent English, I said, your government brings in the radical Islamics. They're funding ISIS. This is a pretext to take freedom. And they just said, well, this is just the way it is. And so it's in the news that any criticism of Juan Carlos the King, who was put in by Francisco Franco, who was Hitler's adjunct basically during World War II, any criticism is prison time. They don't care who you are. I mean, imagine in the West, any criticism of the King of Spain, it's like 500 years ago, is huge fines or prison time. And then under the name of the King, if you say our local police are lazy, they're raising taxes too much, they all basically want swimming pools and hammocks at their bases, you are then fined or arrested. This is in the West, and there's nothing out of the U.S. media. There's some out of the British media, some out of the German media, but it's here. Fascism never really ended in Spain. It's simply back. And I make the point in another video at Infowars.com, the dominoes are beginning to fall and that Spain's the first domino, that this is a sign that the global financial collapse is imminent by engineered design, because they are unveiling classical fascism, classical totalitarianism. And while the very same foundations pushing this are financing attacks on the police, communist terror attacks, and a communist movement as the fake revolution that once the fascists come in, they'll drive her one of the arms of communist in the Hegelian dialectic of problem reaction solution that Carol Quigley wrote about to bring us into this system. So this is so unprecedented. And I talked to folks in the UK. I talked to people here in Spain. We're talking to so many people, and they say, no, the economy's bad. It's getting worse. And they say, it'd be okay, but they keep raising the taxes. I mean, imagine being in France and being about 25% of the public, people making over 100,000 euros a year, and you pay 101%, a retroactive tax, 3 years running, to make you quit, to make you stop, to make you shut down your restaurant, shut down your car dealership, shut down your hotel, shut down your factory, lay off your workers so they go on welfare. And the big mega corporations, tax exempt, above the law, just like with the bank consolidation in the U.S., a little bank shutting down. Under the regulations, I was talking to a major head of a Texas bank that has hundreds of branches. They're shutting down retail. They're shutting down loans. They're shutting down housing loans. They're shutting down everything because the regulations won't let them loan, and the big banks are exempt. Do you understand, folks? This is the takeover. This is feudalism, where the big mega rich like Juan Carlos and others don't want you to have a business, don't want you to have a life, don't want you to compete with them. And then they scapegoat capitalism and blame it for what they themselves are doing that isn't capitalism, that is fascism. I mean, it is so diabolical to see them squeezing people and absolutely harassing them, and to witness this, and it hurts everybody. I don't care who you are in America, who you are in Spain, who you are in France, who you are in the United Kingdom, who you are anywhere in the world, this yoke of corruption, this yoke of mega banks laundering the drug money and running the child kidnapping rings and promoting the abortion and promoting the tyranny and promoting the end of the family. It's because they've taken over through fraud, and every minute they're worried about what could unseat them. Justice, family, community, common sense, information, informed people. Justice and freedom and private wealth threatens the hegemonic monopoly. That's why it's at war with prosperity, at war with free will, at war with everything decent, because it's fundamentally rotten at its core and can't compete with it. But I look at the shining eyes of the Spanish people, and I look at, you know, their strength and how they've thrown off tyranny so many other times, and I know they will. My God, they don't get to vote on EU tyranny, just like the UK, just like England and Scotland and Ireland can vote on fighting with each other all day and can vote on seceding, because it doesn't matter if they secede from the UK. The UK has 92% of its laws. It was 80% last year, made by the unelected dictatorship. David and I, we're going to break in about a minute. I'm going to come back and cover some other issues with you, but it's just amazing to see how open and naked tyranny has now gotten.
Well, Alex, what you were just saying in terms of the European control of the individual states, there's an article today about the European Parliament debating whether they're going to let European countries ban GMO. So now we've seen the same thing there in Europe, and they're trying make this the United States of Europe. Same thing we've seen here with the DARC Act, the supposedly Safe and Accurate Labeling Act that was passed in Congress to shut down any control over food or food labeling by local governments. That's what they're doing in Europe. They're shutting that down for previously sovereign states.
I'm glad you raised that. Three unions, North American, Asian, EU, circumventing national sovereignty. And as you said, just like the TPP, EU, ban labeling. This is the tyranny. This is the end of choice. This is the end of humans being able to vote with their dollars or euros. We'll be back. Infowars.com. I'm coming to you live from Europe. I'm co-hosting with David Knight. We've got some Spanish acoustic guitar bringing us in via Metallica and the great song Battery. Again, I'm your host, Alex Jones, co-hosting with David Knight, who's in Austin, Texas. I'm in Barcelona, Spain. We're going to be covering more events here, but it is shocking to have police march over when you're videotaping in public and say, under new rules, no taping allowed in public, and to then threaten to arrest us, and to just experience that journalists and others that mildly just say, I disagree with the government, I disagree with the king, I disagree with this activity, you are fined or arrested here in Spain. And even mainstream media says it's bizarre police state, bizarre oppression. No, this is the model worldwide. This is what they want to bring in. And under the new EU rules, can't criticize Monsanto. If Spain or Greece or France, who've all banned GMO, trans species, want to say no, doesn't matter. There's no sovereignty, EU says. And I'm glad David Knight raises that, because that is the level of just incredible, colossal, bizarro land, surreal tyranny that we're talking about. And you've got to ask yourself, the globalists are already in control. Why are they doing this? Because they want to be able to put shots in you when they want. They want to be able to take money for national health care and then not give you care. They want to be able to feed you GMO that sterilizes rats and make you accept it. They want to run your life. It's about power. It's about control. It's the same reason these Satanists are showing up protesting to keep killing babies and showing up with Baphomet statues and selling tickets to support abortion, because they got a God and they serve it and they follow it and they live it. They talk the talk, they walk the walk. They may be chicken necked. They may be ugly. They may be stupid. They may be weak, but they know how to serve their God. They know how to tithe. They know how to give. They love their God. Well, forget God, okay, for all you atheists out there. Do you serve anything? Like Bob Dylan says, you got to serve somebody. Well, I serve the truth, and I serve strength and the individual, and I serve the power of the people. And at a fundamental genetic level, I hate these parasites and their big gangs. I mean, we all hate seeing a video on National Geographic of, say, 20 African dogs pulling down a lion and killing it. Or we hate seeing an elephant being taken down by 20, 30 hyenas. And it stomps them and it hits them and it kills 10 of them. But still, they all gang up and pull it down and rip its trunk off and rip its eyes out. You know, at a fundamental level, we just see it for what it is. Predatory, weak, pathetic. Some will argue it's survival of the fittest. Well, I know this. They built an artificial construct to use our energy and our will to build their breakaway civilization. So here's the message. Maybe they're right. Maybe you don't have what it takes. Maybe I don't. Maybe we are dominated. Maybe we are failed. Maybe genetically and spiritually I'm wrong, that I don't want to hurt innocents and I don't want to dumb people down to use them like cattle. Maybe I'm a failure that I didn't join the New World Order and use my intelligence to dominate, make millions of dollars and be immune from prosecution and be above the law. But you know what? My soul says that's a fraud, and I know it is, and I'll never use my knowledge of the world to hurt innocents. I will only use my knowledge of the universe to empower souls and minds for free will. And if the public doesn't listen, if they don't want this message, if they don't want this truth, then that is your choice. But I'm here to make sure you have that choice, be free or be slave. It's an epic moment, a legendary moment, a historic moment to be alive. Choose what side you're on. Don't be lukewarm. We're back in 70 seconds after the break with my final segment. Then, from Albion, the former United Kingdom, now deep behind EU enemy lines, Paul Joseph Watson, David Knight, the rest of the... From Barcelona, more coming from Europe in multiple countries where they have raised the taxes, cut off the resources, shut off the coal power plants to the point that Europe is collapsing. In fact, no country in Europe, statistically, admittedly, has been more economically destroyed than Spain. Spain has had more than 200 major coal-powered clean plants that just put out carbon dioxide and water vapor shut down the last 7-8 years. They put up wind farms that are a boondoggle, that don't supply the energy, that don't deliver the energy to where it's going. They lose about half of it on the lines. And people say, I don't care about coal, screw them. When you take cheap energy and you make it expensive, then no one can have factories, no one can have jobs. People have less discretionary income. It's all going to pay for your power bill. The electric cars go off of it. Everything slows down. I mean, the first thing you do in a military operation in World War II or Korea or Vietnam is bomb power plants. Well, the globalists don't bomb power plants. They just go, hey, I'm trendy. I'm a liberal. We're going to shut your power plants off. It's for the earth. knowing that they want you to have less discretionary income. They go, hey, it's trendy. 250 square foot apartments so we can raise your taxes on you. I mean, it's feudalism. Feudalism was about keeping people at a subsistence level or below it as political control. So you were so busy under economic domination that you couldn't ever be involved in anything else. So the nobility could ride by on their horses and look at the commoners who were about a foot or two shorter from malnutrition, and they have 5-6 kids. Two of them would be from mineral deficiencies, totally mentally retarded. This is in Japanese culture, European culture, Aztec culture, and they would call them the little people. They'd have snot all over their faces, starving, and they'd ride by, keeping on about 5-10% of the land to survive. If you killed a rabbit or a deer to eat, they'd kill your whole family, slit your throats, hang upside down, burn at the stake, whatever. And it's back the same deal. It's feudalism, same royalty, same people, same scum, mixed up with the Rothschilds. And that's austerity. That's Agenda 21. That's their plan. And once they get you addicted, though, to free government handouts, and welfare, then they think you'll stay bound to the system as they slowly turn off the resources. The truth is, free market can deliver unlimited resources, unlimited renaissance, anything you can imagine. Look how much we've progressed in 100 years. But globalism is about stopping that progression and only letting you have resources and tools and technology that are Trojan horses delivered from the gods in the Pelennor fields, in the golden fields of Elysium. And so we need to understand, we don't want to break away Elysium, the Greek legend of those that serve the gods, those that serve the elite, given life extension, given the power. We understand the human mind that envisioned Elysium, can build the fire of Prometheus for everyone, and it's not the devil who lies and tells the occult that he is Prometheus. It is the God of the heavens that has given us the Promethean fire to be able to go to the next level, and the system will never be able to suppress the human spirit from attaining that fire. You do not have to serve the Illuminati to gain the fire. That is a false fire. That is a false light. The Illuminati is not illumined. And you will only be illuminated when you have God in your heart and realize that what you do to the least of me, you've done to me, as Christ said. So I'm going to throw it back to David Knight, who's doing a fabulous job co-hosting the show. I'll be back tomorrow, Lord willing, live, more street reports, more on the ground reports. The other reports we haven't aired yet today are on Infowars.com. If you want to air some of those with Watson, do. What are the names of the reports? We shot like three or four. That one of them's got bad audio. We're trying to fix it, where I saw the street musician that was levitating, and I point out how it ties in the private Federal Reserve and its con game of creating, you know, false money, how you're a conspiracy theorist if you point out how the guy levitating in the streets of Barcelona isn't really levitating. It's a pretty powerful video. We've got a bunch of those coming up at Infowars.com, but I'm just excited about the energy of humanity and the fact that in my gut, in my spirit, I know we're going to prevail over this tyranny. But the enemy attack is launching, is intensifying. So God bless you all, David Knight.
We're going to be joined by Paul Joseph Watson in just a moment. He's going to talk to us about the University of New Hampshire's bias-free language guide. We're going to talk to him about that story in just a moment. And, of course, we're going to have Alex Jones, who is just on with us live from Spain. He has a report that he's filed. We're going to play that at the bottom of the hour. Spain, the next domino to fall. Before I go to Paul, I just want to let you know that this hour of the Alex Jones Show is brought to you by the products that we sell at InfowarsLife.com. Products like Survival Shield X2. And, of course, we have a lot of reviews about Survival Shield X2 at our site. We have over 400 reviews at InfowarsLife.com. Over 99% of those respondents would recommend it to a family or a friend. Let me read you a couple of those right now. Archie the Bladesmith from Logan, West Virginia, says, I take it every day since I first bought the older nascent iodine several months ago. X2 wasn't out then, but it's much stronger. I think more clearly. My skin has cleared up a bit. More energy. It does everything it's reported to do. I will continue to use it as long as it's available. Another one from Happy Chappie in England, UK. He says, I've been taking X2 for a year now. It's changed my life in many ways. I feel I have more energy, a clear mind, feel good. The biggest change for me was depression. I would find myself depressed one day, fine the next, but since taking X2, I haven't been depressed at all. Also have not been ill in any way, shape, or form. And the number of people that tell me I'm looking well has gone from never to all the time. Thanks, Alex, for waking me up. We had a lot of people talk about unusual things like that. We had someone tell us that they thought that it helped them to quit smoking. If you've got a nutritional deficiency, there's no telling how it's going to manifest itself in your body. Right now, you can get Survival Shield X2 Nascent Iodine. It's in stock. It's a good time to stock up because we have free shipping. In July, we have free shipping at all products that we sell at InfowarsLife.com. And of course, July is going to end tomorrow. So if you want to stock up on a supply of Survival Shield X2, if you want to get silver, it's a good time. We've got a special on that. Buy two silver, get two free. So you get it for half off. Buy four, buy two, and you get four. Half off the regular price. All these are free shipping today and tomorrow at InfowarsLife.com. Now, going to this article that Paul Joseph Watson has up on Infowars.com, University of New Hampshire says using the word American is defensive, but not just that word. They have a long list: obese, normal, mothering, fathering, senior citizen, homosexual, illegal alien. Those are all discouraged. You know, Paul, I'd like to see if they could come up with a euphemism for bald, so I didn't have to feel so bad about losing my hair. You know, I still wouldn't grow hair, but I could feel better about it maybe for a little while. What do you think?
Well, that's partly what it's about, David. It's about this cult of victimhood. Mm-hmm. Where, you know, instead of facing up to people's problems, like, you know, obese, for example, you've got the whole fat pride movement, which tries to take obesity, of course, which is incredibly unhealthy and should not be encouraged, and turn it into this social justice warrior movement. So this is a bias-free language guide posted on the official University of New Hampshire website. And to his credit, the University of New Hampshire president has come out. Even he has come out and basically said this is ridiculous. Of course, they say using the word American is offensive because it's not inclusive of people from South America. All those other examples you mentioned, normal, mothering, fathering, homosexual, illegal alien, senior citizens, they're all offensive and they're all to be discouraged. But what this is about is, again, mainstreaming lunacy. People pick holes in some articles that I write and say, well, this is just some idiots, some extreme leftist radicals on Twitter or Tumblr that are coming out with this. But it's not. As we saw with a previous article from the University of Wisconsin, where they said that complimenting people of color or saying, for example, that an Asian person is good at maths is a racial microaggression. And this is coming from the universities. This is what faculty and students are being taught. So it's not just some extreme crazy radicals on the internet. This is what the next generation is learning. This is what is being mainstreamed right now in America at the college level.
Absolutely, Paul. You know, when I look at this, when we look at language control, that's really about population control. Just like we talk about gun control, that's really population control. This is about intimidating people, isn't it, Paul? It's about creating a climate of intimidation. And it's also, when we look at political terms, I mean, that's a huge political aspect right there. But when we look at some of these political terms, they're really seizing the high ground of political debate. Because if you can define the terms, you can define the argument. So there's multiple aspects of this that we should all be very worried about. But I think the key thing to me in looking at all this, at first glance, it looks silly, it looks hypersensitive, it looks politically correct, but it really is a form of control and intimidation.
Yeah, it's about changing the definition of words and phrases. It's not about being sensitive to people and not wanting to offend people. Look at the examples. You know, they say calling people illegal aliens is politically incorrect, offensive, but then what do they suggest it's replaced with? Quote, person seeking asylum or refugee. So, of course, that completely eliminates all the pejorative context from illegal immigrant, somebody breaking the law to illegally enter the country, and turns them into some kind of political refugee. The same with other examples. As I said, you know, they say replace obese or overweight with, quote, people of size. So again, that completely eliminates the context that being obese is a bad thing and not something that should be accepted or encouraged. Of course, we're not going to bully people and call them names because they're overweight. But the whole fat pride movement that this is attached to actually encourages body positivity for grossly obese people. So it's actually harming their health, making them more likely to succumb to terminal illnesses. They also talk about cis-centrism, which, quote, includes the lack of gender-neutral restrooms, locker rooms, and residences at the university. So again, it's all about creating this cult of victimhood where everybody's a special little snowflake and your free speech, your language, the very words that you use need to be curtailed, even at university, which is supposed to be a bastion of free speech where open free discussion is encouraged. Now in many universities in America, it's the opposite. You know, they have safe spaces when dissident feminists like Christina Hoff Sommers go to a university to do a talk about how insane third wave feminism is. These students have to escape to these safe spaces where they won't come in contact with any of the talking points that she brings to her presentation. So instead of being about open and free discussion, which is what universities were about in the past and should be about, it's about curtailing free speech. It's about censorious programs that dictate that this kind of language is some kind of thought crime, and even to utter it is to be offensive and politically incorrect.
Yeah, you know, it's been that way at university for a long time. I'm pretty old. I went when I was getting my electrical engineering degree. I had to be very careful about the classes, the professors that I had, because there were all these Marxists, basically, that were trying to harass and intimidate you to use their classes as a tool of social control, as a tool of manipulation. But of course, now all the guilt tripping about white privilege has become systemic throughout the universities, all of them, pretty much. And of course, the MTV program that we covered before. I really hate to see this kind of cultural Marxism. Again, as I said, it's just a form of control and intimidation. And it's absolutely outrageous. It's also ridiculous when we look at things like obese or overweight being replaced by the euphemism people of size. People of size. Of what size? That's the issue, I guess, right, Paul?
Yeah, I mean, you mentioned the MTV thing again. A lot of actual liberals, though, you'll find now, are coming out and rebelling against this because they see that basically the craziest people have seized control of the dialogue, of the narrative, and now they're in these key positions of power at universities, in the media. Not only did we have the MTV White Privilege show, which aired about a week ago now, you know, telling white people that they should be ashamed, for example, about what happened to the Native Americans, which they have no connection to whatsoever, despite the fact that, you know, all the Native American tribes were killing each other. That doesn't matter. It's white people that are evil. And then after that, they put out another video, which again touched upon the University of Wisconsin microaggressions, things like, you know, saying that you liked black culture was racist, but also not liking black culture was racist. So basically, whatever you say, you're racist. If you're white, you're born a racist, which is basically what these social justice warriors believe. And then you have to live your entire life as an act of apology simply for your skin color, which is, of course, inherently racist. So this is coming out at the educational level. It's coming out at the media level. And, you know, if you're active on Twitter, as I am, you know that these people have seized control of the narrative in many areas of political discussion on Twitter. And that's why it's a big threat, because they are controlling the narrative to a great extent. And if you're not embroiled in that on a day-to-day basis, as I am, then it's easy to dismiss it as just some radical extremists on Tumblr or whatever. But, you know, this has gone really far now with all these different free speech guides being given to students and faculty members at universities, telling them what they can and can't say, and, you know, something that might offend the precious little snowflakes. And it is a threat to free speech, and it's a growing one.
You know, there's a little bit of schadenfreude here, Paul, on my part. When I look at this and I look at the nonsense of this, the Marxism of this, I'm thinking that these people are paying fantastic amounts of money to go into debt in a university system, getting a degree that is going to be absolutely irrelevant and useless to their lives. So that's going to, you know, what goes around comes around. Before we go to break, and we're going to be back with Paul in the next segment, we have a breaking story from Mikhail Phelan at InfoWars. Of course, he broke the news in an interview with hackers a couple of days ago, saying they were looking at the Planned Parenthood emails. Now, this second claimed hack that happened, those hackers are saying that Planned Parenthood faked that attack so they could use it as fundraising. Check out that story at InfoWars.com. Hackers behind Planned Parenthood breach accused company of faking second attack to provoke donations. We'll be right back. Joining us now is Paul Joseph Watson from the UK. We've been talking about the weaponization of our language that is taking place primarily in the universities. That's where they're beginning all of this, the preoccupation with white privilege. Now it's taken to an absurd level at the University of New Hampshire, where they have a bias-free language guide, where they're basically redefining everything. But understand that behind this is not just about intimidation of people. That's a big part of it. They talk about microaggression. Really, they're the ones being aggressive. But language control, like gun control, like transportation control, is people control. That's fundamentally what this is about. This is what these Marxists are really trying to do, as well as defining the terms of the debate and seizing the high ground by defining those terms. Going back to Paul Joseph Watson, Paul, break this down some more for us.
Yeah, it's exactly that. It's about hijacking the terms that we all use on a day-to-day basis. and either saying that now they mean something else or that they're racist and politically incorrect. I mean, Alex talks about it often. You know, they stop using the term brown bags up in Seattle because that could be considered racist. And every single day I post examples from people who are going to these universities. They post stuff on Twitter like, you know, if you order beef well done, then that's racist because there's a history of white people giving spoiled beef to African-American slaves. And it's that kind of insanity that now dominates much of the narrative. And it's also now took firm grasp in universities. And that's why we're seeing more of this come out every single week now.
Yeah, it also underscores, as we said before, how silly and irrelevant the universities have become, hasn't it? I would not call them institutions of higher learning for most cases. I don't think people need to go into massive debt to get most of these degrees. I mean, even for technical degrees or law degrees or doctor degrees, I mean, that's the only way you can get into those fields. Nevertheless, it's starting to get to the point where it doesn't really pay.
Well, no, and then they complain about, you know, the gender pay gap while taking gender studies degrees that are no good to anyone. You're not going to get a job out of it. So, you know, it's a vicious circle. And then going on to this, you know, Cecil the Lion controversy, which you talked about yesterday. Of course, trophy hunting is reprehensible. It's basically just shooting something that's been imprisoned in a pen and then posing with its dead body. It actually discredits hunting. It's reprehensible. But the thing about this Cecil the Lion issue is Peter came out and accused this Walter Palmer, this lion hunter, of, quote, lacking empathy, understanding, and respect for living creatures. This is an organization that literally their business model revolves around slaughtering healthy, defenseless animals. 96% of the animals that come through Peter's doors end up dead. So Peter is out there lecturing us all on how such a big shame this Cecil the Lion killing is, which it is. Meanwhile, they're literally killing healthy kittens and dumping them in garbage bags while people give their donations to Peter in the name of Cecil the Lion. So again, just this rampant hypocrisy that surrounds all these contrived outrage campaigns. Yes, it's outrageous, but then to allow people who are so hypocritical to seize that narrative and use it to raise money, again, is completely reprehensible. And that's what Peter's doing right now.
And of course, we see all these organizations. There's a story by Kit Daniels talking about how leftists suggest that African lions are more important than African Americans, because they certainly do care less about all the murders by African Americans than they do about Cecil the Lion, if you look at the number of column inches that they devote to this. As I was saying earlier, you know, yeah, trophy hunting, that's one issue. But let's talk about the Planned Parenthood people. They don't talk about that either. They don't talk about how they're doing, how they're hunting babies to essentially buy their trophy cars and their trophy homes. I find that abhorrent.
Well, the Cecil the Lion issue got more coverage from U.S. news networks in one day than the Planned Parenthood videos have received over the past 2 weeks.
Yes.
And then again, you look at somebody like Kermit Gosnell, you know, who killed babies after they were born. It took 56 days for all three broadcast networks in the U.S. to even report on that. And there was no huge public shaming campaign against Kermit Gosnell, because that wasn't liberal, that wasn't trendy. So again, we care more about big cats than we do defenseless human babies, and that's a big problem.
Well, you know, actually, you know, Paul, you're talking about Kermit Gosnell. We talked about the fourth video. They're coming out very rapidly now. I think they're trying to do it before they get a restraining order put on there. And we had in this fourth video, they say sometimes if someone delivers before we get to see them for a procedure, then we have an intact baby. That's the ghoulishness of these people who are out there looking for their Lambos. Stay with us right after the break. We're going to have a special report from Alex Jones, Spain, the next domino to fall. We'll be right back. Earlier in the show, we were joined live by Alex Jones in Spain. And of course, Alex is going to the various European countries that are on the perimeter looking to see if they're going to do to Spain, to Italy, these other countries, what they are doing to Greece. And of course, we just learned today that although it looked like Greece had been forced to accept a recessionary bailout deal, that's what Tsipras said. He said, well, we're not proud of it, but we have created some cracks in European neoliberal hegemony. Well, no, you didn't. Because even as bad as this second deal is, and it was far worse than the first deal that the Greek people said no to, but that Tsipras, their socialist leader, said yes to, As bad as that deal was, now the IMF is saying in private memos that have come out from London Financial Times. Yes, the Financial Times, and this was also put out by Business Insider, saying leaked memos say that IMF negotiators are not interested in participating in policy discussions until other conditions are met. So IMF is looking like they're going to back out of this as well. Alex Jones is filing reports as he's going through these countries in Europe. We have another one right here. Spain, the next domino to fall. Here's Alex Jones's report.
I want to be clear as we report from the hilltops above Barcelona, Spain. The New World Order global corporate fascist combine is not a Nazi conspiracy. It is not a Nazi conspiracy. The Nazis themselves were a spinoff of the robber barons of Europe, England, and the United States trying to formulate a governmental plan for the world. And there was a debate between communism and fascism. This is in the mainline history books around the time of 1900. They bankrolled both major movements. All the big mega banks, powerful combines, had made their fortunes by funding both sides over and over and over again. But when you look at Spain, this parallel has never been clearer. It was the Treaty of Rome in 57 that set up the European Union as a so-called trade deal, just like NAFTA and GATT, by stealth. Now, as they implode the nation states with artificial debt, their answer is get rid of any sovereignty. This is in the news. And transfer all power to the unelected EU dictatorship that is run by the same private central banks that have gotten the countries to sign on the debt. And then when you look at the parallels of how Spain was fascist in World War II and then never got in any trouble for it right up until 1975 when Francisco Franco handed over power to Juan Carlos and passed through the power chain down to pick the prince who he personally trained and groomed to be the successor, who is in control of Spain today. And they just have a semi, you know, vestigial elected government. Or ceremonial is more the word. They act like the king is ceremonial and vestigial, but in truth, he has the constitutional powers and the control. And again, they were able to get the people to support the fascist model because the alternative is to be invaded basically by the Middle East and Africa and taken over and to go under Islamic rule or to have gone under communist rule. So this is why the globalists time and time again end up funding both sides of any equation, or in some cases all three sides, is so that they can then judge the outcome of the battle and then throw their weight behind the organization that basically works with them and goes along with their ultimate plan. Sometimes they'll even betray a group that works with them and then double back and put somebody else in control. And what happened to Hitler and Mussolini was a great example of that. They were basically set up. You want to come and talk? All right, brother. A lot of folks recognize InfoWars, which is exciting. It shows people understand what's happening. And so you have to understand the EU is a totalitarian movement. It is destroying sovereignty, and any country that goes along with its demands never gets out of debt. You only get more debt. And you end up with 50% unemployment like some areas, 40% unemployment that Spain has, because they want you domesticated. They use economic warfare as a tool of control. And whether it's fascist crony capitalism or whether it's communism, they don't care because it's centralized. And Carol Quigley, in his book Tragedy and Hope, that was written secretly for the State Department but then later released, admits all this. It's an 1,100-page book. It's on the Scribe and different sites online. We sell the book at InfoWarsStore.com if you want to read it. It's back in print. You can read The Anglo-American Establishment, written by Carol Quigley. You can read Brzezinski's 5 books. What's so frustrating to me is this is all admitted. Brzezinski, in his book The Technotronic Era, written in the 70s, admits the governments control the narcotics trade. He admits that they finance both sides of the wars and that that's how they control people. They put Mao Zedong into power, who killed, you know, 80-plus million people. So just understand, these people are absolutely evil. And I use the Emperor Palpatine analogy a lot, because when Episode 3 came out a decade ago, mainstream news said, we don't understand this plot. We don't get it. First, they're fighting against the Trade Federation, then they're not fighting against it, and then all of a sudden, the Emperor takes over. Well, he's a senator who stages an attack on his planet to get more power, and to become prominent. Then he gets elected chancellor, gets more power out of the next terror attack that happens. And then finally he wipes out the internal police forces and the old republic to make himself dictator, doubling back and saying that they're the terrorist. See, that's exactly what's happening in America with the Liberty Movement. They claim the police state is to fight radical Islamic terror, but then they turn around and they say that it's for the veterans, the gun owners, the patriots, the old republic. I mean, and Lucas even came out in a Vanity Fair article. Well, he gave a press conference. It was in Vanity Fair. It was also in Hollywood Reporter, and said, "Don't you get it? This is what happened on 9/11." He says, "I'm going to leave it at that, but this movie, I rewrote it. Episode 3. This is 9/11, which is where a central government gets power out of basically financing an outside group to attack, letting them attack, then turning around, double-crossing them, taking the liberties domestically, but also conquering the outlying planets," which you interchange for outlying countries. This is Hegelian dialectic. This is Machiavellian systems. It's not that complex. But see, the public couldn't understand it because it was so real as an allegory. Just come out of the cave, break your conditioning, realize what's happening, and realize that they're warning the public and the press, don't even talk about this here. And that's why we then dared to come here. I was just going to go to Greece and just go to Italy. But then when I saw the major shift in Spain that's been happening for a long time towards total fascism, we had to come here and see this historical event as it unfolds. The people built that. Their art, their beauty. It's a wonderful culture here in Spain. And it's sad to see it caught between radical Islamic garbage and communism and being forced to go with fascism. And the people have a lot of courage here. They have a lot of honor. I believe that Spain is going to be able to come through this. They've so far bowed to the EU on record and are just being torn apart. And it just gets worse and worse to see the EU being able to do this. And it was a proto-Nazi program to conquer Europe by economics, not by military control. So Spain couldn't be conquered or reconquered itself from radical Islam. Spain threw off so many other invasions and so many other attacks. Spain once was a greater empire than the England. And now they've been conquered by a bunch of slimy bankers in suits who have their puppet king who they finance and control. I mean, I've been to Bilderberg when Juan Carlos is there meeting secretly. And that's why they don't want this discussed. They don't want the public to even know. Daniel Estulin, who lives in Spain, has the number one best-selling book here for like a decade running because the people are hungry for the truth. And so that's the good news. And I believe we have courage and stand up against this, that Spain and the rest of the world can find a way out of this. But Spain is next probably to be collapsed, that or Portugal, and then Italy. We're going to Rome to show what the London Telegraph and others have said is basically imminent collapse. All right, that's another report from the ground. We'll be talking to folks on the street and more. A lot of key reports coming up. Alex Jones for InfoWars.com.
Again, that's Alex Jones reporting from Spain. Spain, the next domino to fall. That's the name of that report. And as we were talking to Alex when he was on with us live, we were talking about how, you know, many people are concerned about what happened in Greece. Certainly the people have gotten a horrible deal there. Part of that deal is taking away their sovereignty, starting to dictate to them how their laws are going to be, laws that might affect the bankers' profits. And even this bad second deal is now being reneged on by the IMF, according to documents that have been leaked to the Financial Times. We can see that it's not just Greece, however, where they're taking over control. The European Parliament is debating whether they will let individual countries ban GMOs. The same thing we see happening in this country. So they've already lost their sovereignty. Look at what's happening in the United States. And of course, this is all what the Trans-Pacific, Transatlantic Partnerships are about. It's about turning over the sovereignty of our countries to the corporations who are writing those agreements. They will then prohibit at a global level anything that will harm the profits of big pharmaceutical companies, of big corporations like Monsanto. They will establish extensive copyright controls over everything. And those copyright controls will not only make them incredibly rich, leave them the owners of everything, but it will also be used to control the internet as a means of saying that they have to exercise internet control. We have this article showing what's happening here in the United States. Of course, Boehner and McConnell are destroying the party from the top. This is from WND. Well, I would say I don't really care if Boehner and McConnell destroy the party. They don't care about the GOP. I don't care about the GOP. We care about issues. But of course, regardless of what happens to the country, and of course, the open borders are about bringing in cheap labor, exporting jobs, importing workers for their corporate masters, people like the U.S. Chamber of Commerce. That's why Boehner and McConnell won't do anything. That's why nobody else in the GOP will do anything. You've been had. It was less than a year ago that you voted for them to do something about Obamacare, which is crony capitalism. You voted for them to do something about the open borders, which is crony capitalism, really. But of course, they're not. Instead, what they did was they handed over their sovereignty, their responsibility, their duty to pass legislative laws. They've handed that over now to the corporate lobbyists who are writing these sovereignty-destroying, economy-destroying treaties that they call free trade. That's what this has all been about. You know, they sell us the runaway welfare state, and they do that in other countries like Venezuela and Greece. They do that best with a socialist at the helm. But it also works with Republicans there as well, because this is fundamentally corporatism. It is fundamentally fascism. As Alex was pointing out, they have these phony two different sides. They put Mao in charge. It was German bankers who put Lenin in charge of Russia, but then we were told that Hitler and Russia were on opposite sides. No, not true. It's the same guys who are running this scam everywhere. Let's talk about the open borders. Let's use that term that we're not supposed to say, illegal alien. Yes, because alien means that they're not a citizen, and illegal means that they are doing this. They're here in violation, non-citizens in violation of the law. We have a story up on Infowars.com. Angry judge rails against the immigration system as an illegal alien faces rape and murder charges. He says, we don't even know who he is. Now, what has happened here? This is a story from BizPak Review. They say failure to enforce immigration laws has again left an innocent woman shot to death, another wounded, a teenager sexually assaulted, and a judge on the warpath. An illegal alien, 35, is accused of fatally shooting a 60-year-old woman, attempting to kill another woman, attempting to rape his own 14-year-old niece on Monday. And this came just weeks after the U.S. Border Patrol refused to take him into custody because he hadn't committed a crime other than being here illegally, because those crimes don't matter. Selective enforcement of the law. How about equal protection of the law for American citizens? Let's play the clip from WKYC.
Turns out, police met Razzo at least once before. 3 weeks ago, Lake County Sheriff's deputies responding to calls of a suspicious vehicle at a Painesville golf course. Razzo comes out from a wooded area and admits to being in the U.S. illegally, the report says. A call to U.S. Border Patrol and a detective decides not to retain Razzo, and he was free to go.
So he's free to go. Again, catch and release. They don't do this for Americans. We can have illegal aliens under the Secure Communities Act. They were supposed to have been turned over to ICE if they had fingerprints on file. That would mean that they had previously created a crime, meaning that could be something where they were deported once and then they decided, well, you know, I really still don't care about your borders, so I'm going to come back in again. Or it could be a violent crime. But they were supposed to turn them over to ICE to deport them. Because you know what? When you violate the immigration laws, you're still violating the laws. But of course, as we've seen here in Austin, and I went to a meeting where the Democrat Party harangued a black Democrat sheriff and told him, you're in the wrong party. You're supporting this Secure Communities Act. And he says, I'm simply doing my job as law enforcement. When I see people who have a criminal record, I am turning them over as I'm required to do under federal law. But they wanted him to ignore the law, to violate the law. And of course, our police chief, Art Acevedo, is doing that. So this guy gets turned loose, and he goes out, and again, as I mentioned, he killed a 60-year-old woman. He attempted to kill another woman. He attempted to rape his 14-year-old. And when he's brought before the judge, this is what the judge has to say.
I can't set a bond high enough. I cannot set one high enough. At least I have somebody that we don't even know who he is, why he's in this country, why he's here illegally, and why he allegedly committed a murder.
Finally, we get somebody who is angry about this. It's good to see that happening. You know, I was just talking in the last, in the first half hour to Paul Joseph Watson. And we're talking about how language is being manipulated. I saw this amazing interview on NPR with Woody Allen. And as part of this interview, listen to how they play with language. They come to him and they say, the separation between church and state, between artists and their personal lives, do you think the allegations that you sexually abused your adopted daughter, Dylan Farrow, do you think those have affected how people approach your movies? You hear that? Do you hear that? If he's got allegations of him sexually abusing his adopted daughter, then that's just a separation of church and state issue. Really? According to NPR, that's just a separation of church and state. And of course, it's not just that. It's Woody Allen's interview, which is making headlines in all different kinds of outlets, where he's talking about his quote-unquote paternal relationship with Soon Yi. Now, to back this all up, Woody Allen at the time was living with Mia Farrow. They didn't officially get married, but they adopted children together. They had a child together. And she also had adopted children from a previous marriage. One of those was Soon Yi. When their relationship began, she was 8 years old. When that relationship ended, Soon Yi was 20 years old. The reason that relationship between Mia Farrow and Soon Yi ended was because Mia Farrow found nude pictures of Soon Yi that Woody Allen had taken. I don't know what age she was when that happened. But that in and of itself should raise a lot of questions, especially the fact that Woody Allen starts talking about in this interview how he says, I was paternal. She responded to someone paternal. Now, he switched a couple of letters around there. He was parental. He was parental. Okay? He was 62 at the time, and she was 20. He was her parent. He had a parent relationship with her. But he says, she responded to someone paternal. I liked her youth and energy. It was just a fling. But then there became more of it, and we got serious. So he got serious about this 20-year-old when he's 62 years old and he's her parent. But of course, all this can just be dismissed as some kind of a weirdo separation of church and state issue. You know, we shouldn't get into that. We have completely lost our moral foundation. Stay with us. We'll be right back. Just want to remind you that this hour of the Alex Jones Show has been brought to you by the products that we sell at InfoWarsLife.com. Products like Silver Bullet. And right now we have put in a special. Buy two Silver Bullet, get two free. And of course we have free shipping through the end of July, which is tomorrow. So if you get Silver Bullet, if you buy two of them, you get four of them. Half price off and you get free shipping. Silver Bullet is a powerful colloidal silver product, free of artificial additives, perfect for your preparedness supply, concentrated to 30 parts per million in a pure base of deionized water. There's a reason that listeners have dubbed Silver Bullet as their preparedness silver. That's right. While it's in stock, you can stock up on it. It's not going to go bad. And you can get it with free shipping and at half price. Buy two, get two free. Now, coming back to the news, we had a story that I didn't get to yesterday. It made me think about it when I was talking about Woody Allen in the last segment, because kind of like, you know, you've seen the pictures of Jonathan Pryce, the actor who was in Brazil, and the current Pope. I mean, they look like doppelgangers. I mean, these guys look like they were brothers, separate, twin brothers, separated at birth. When I was talking about Woody Allen, it reminded me of Alan Dershowitz's story. He came out and said, the Second Amendment is an absurd thing in our Constitution. If I could write the Bill of Rights over again, I would skip Amendment Number 2. This is a Harvard law professor, emeritus. He said, we've tried an experiment for the last 250 years, and it's failed miserably. We have to start a new approach. Well, I would say that the experiment of America, of constitutional America, was really only tried for about 80 years, and we created a corporate empire. It was a corporation, and it was an empire, not a republic. He says, if I could write the Bill of Rights over again, I would skip Amendment Number 2. We're the only country in the world that puts in our Constitution the right to bear arms. It's an absurd thing to be in our Constitution, but it's in our Constitution. We have to live with it. Well, at least he says that. At least he doesn't just ignore it, like the Supreme Court, like our legislators at the state level, at the local level, at the national level. That is an absolute right. It was not established by the Constitution. It was a recognition of fundamental human rights, and the Second Amendment is a prohibition of the government's actions. But of course, now we've taken the opposite approach. We understand now, today, we've been taught that everything is prohibited unless expressly permitted by the government. And that applies to drugs of any kind of sort. It's not just the DEA that prohibits everything unless they expressly permit it. It is also the FDA that does that. For cancer drugs, for other things, you have to get their permission before you can do any of it. We've seen some good news that has come out recently. Yesterday, we had a story up on Infowars.com where you can watch the historic Denver Fluoridation Forum. This is the first information session on the issue, and it is pressure to end fluoridation in that area. Nevertheless, today we have an article up on InfoWars, so you win some, you lose some. It's a constant battle. Watch out for this gender-bending plastic chemical that isn't BPA. So people become aware of what the problem is with BPA. They come to their government. They get it prohibited, and unlike GMOs, it's not been pushed back at the national or international level, as they're now doing with GMO legislation. But then they come up with a substitute chemical, and that appears to be every bit as bad. And again, I want to remind you, take a look at this article. We didn't have time to talk about it a great deal, as we've been talking about the fourth video that has come out about the Planned Parenthood stings. There was evidence that they are talking about taking children that were born live and saying, yeah, that one's intact. That is an amazing confession. And we have an article up on Infowars.com. The hacker group that Mikhail Thelen talked to a couple of days ago, saying that they had hacked Planned Parenthood's emails, they're now saying that this second hack, taking down the email site, was a setup for donations. Join us tonight at 7 Central, 8 p.m. Eastern.